Since making the review of the California Air Tools air compressor, I've had a number of people ask me about the sandblaster that I'm using. It's a single-piece molded plastic benchtop unit from Cyclone Manufacturing of Michigan. This model may not be available anymore. I got this one from a seller on eBay. I'd previously owned another sandblaster from Cyclone. It was a floor sanding model, single molded plastic version as well. I really like these molded plastic sandblasters because there's no seams for the abrasive to seep out. In this video, I'd like to show you some improvements I made to the sandblaster. Later in the video, we'll look at how the sandblaster performs on the California Air Tools compressor. The sandblaster doesn't have a great deal of circulation, and there's a lot of debris that gets kicked up in the air, obscuring vision. There's a large ventilation port on the back, but the only thing that this does is let sand escape. The glass beads create a bearing surface can be really slick on the floor. There's another crudely cut hole in the side, I suppose, for some type of vacuum attachment. The hollow legs capture about a liter and a half of abrasive. This would be okay, except when you go to change the abrasive. You may want to clean that abrasive out to prevent cross-contamination. We'll fill the voids in the legs using concrete, and first we'll use a crevice tool and a vacuum to clean them out. Before returning the abrasive to its bucket, we'll sieve out any large chunks. I've had this little fishnet since I was 8 years old, and before that my brother probably used it. For blasting, I mainly use glass beads. It works well for aluminum parts to remove the machining marks and leaves a nice matte finish. To fill the hollow legs, we'll use 8 pounds of cement patch. I didn't know if the cement would stick well to the polyethylene, but there's a polymer admixture that's in this patching compound that maybe is helping it to adhere. Mike, if you're watching, let me know if you need any purple gloves. The 8 pounds of cement also helps to stabilize the sandblaster on the bench. Without that extra weight, the blaster has a tendency to move around. The next thing we'll do is improve the ventilation system, first by removing this rear grating. We'll use the rear larger hole for attaching the vacuum and the side smaller hole for the air inlet. This is a solid model of the parts we'll make to improve the ventilation. The two larger rectangular parts are baffles that mount inside of the sandblaster. The baffle on the left side has a couple of extra bosses that provide support for the vacuum attachment. The vacuum attachment is a loft surface that transitions into a flange, has a slight taper to it to receive the vacuum hose. The vacuum adapter slides through the large hole in the rear of the sandblaster, and then a cover plate fills any gaps around the vacuum adapter. All the ventilation improvement parts are 3D printed in ABS. 3D printing really shines on a part like this. Thin walled, lofting surfaces, slight taper. I'm sure this part could also be made with subtractive machining, but it just seems like there'd be a lot of waste in doing so. On a TAS 5 3D printer and using Simplify 3D, the vacuum adapter took about an hour and a half to print, and the baffles took about 2 hours to print. Mainly I print with 100% infill, and that lets me do secondary machining operations such as drilling. The drilled holes then receive heat set inserts. These are pretty useful. I'll make a supplemental video in case you have an interest. For manual drilling and cutting, it's hard to beat a full-size template. Before I install this, I'll just show you the components. I have this baffle which goes on the inside of the sandblaster. This is the vacuum adapter which goes through this large through hole. And then on the outside, there is a part that surrounds this crudely cut hole, just hides it a little bit. And then we'll put screws through all these holes, and that is what will hold everything in place. With our ventilation system in place and the vacuum running, a quick test to see if we have vacuum in the cabinet. These are 60 to 120 mesh glass beads. The pail is 50 pounds and I put roughly a third of the pail into the blaster. The nice thing about glass beads is that they remove crud off the surface without affecting the surface much. This is the base of a hummingbird feeder and I think it's made of copper. This part is a great example of what I'll use the blaster for. It's a part that's been machined on the CNC mill, and there's machining marks that remain, and I just want to clean those off and give a uniform finish. This leaves a great surface that you can leave as is, or paint or anodize. While it's better to deburr before bead blasting, the glass beads do have enough force that they can remove small burrs. While little to no material is removed from the surface, glass beads do peen the surface. This is a fly-cut aluminum surface magnified 45 times. This is a similar surface after being bead blasted. I don't have a method to measure surface roughness. The bead blasted surface is rougher, it's grippier, and it's uniform with reduced machining marks. While it's subjective and a personal choice, I really like the appearance of a bead blasted surface. In general, I really like sandblasting old stuff because you restore that old luster that's been lost. Here's an old brass ornament that I used to use on a Tesla coil. After bead blasting, the corrosion's removed and the metal's left untouched. Here's a softer metal, a bit of copper, and while bead blasting did smooth the surface slightly, it mainly only improved the luster. All the ventilation parts were made from ABS, and I wondered how well it would stand up to bead blasting. The crud's been removed, and even with the nozzle pointed directly at the plastic wasn't damaged. The gun of a sandblaster is the most important part. And since not all of them are constructed the same way, I'd like to show you how this one is constructed so you have some reference when comparing other units. This gun separates into four pieces. The handle, this barrel assembly, a nozzle, and an orifice inside. It's not terribly easy to separate this barrel off. I want to do this to show the size difference between the orifice that it came with and talk a little bit about the air requirements each of them had. So here's the barrel assembly separated from the handle, of course the nozzle, barrel, and then the orifice is inside here. Just pull that out. It's a couple of O-rings that are on the orifice. This one came with two orifices. This smaller diameter one, or the hole is smaller in the orifice and then a larger one. The larger size orifice is 1/8 inch diameter. The smaller orifice is 5/64 inch. According to the tables that I found, the 1/8 inch orifice should be fine for 5 CFM. But with the California Air Tools compressor, this orifice would quickly empty the tank. The 5/64 orifice works pretty well with the California Air Tools 5 CFM compressor. It could probably be a little bit smaller, and it would, the compressor would be able to keep up with the air requirements a little bit better. The nozzles were the same. It came with two, and for all intents and purposes, they are the same. There is some buildup you can see inside of here. I think that's from water that got into the airstream. To measure the performance of the air compressor, we'll measure the tank pressure during blasting and then during recovery. With the 5/64 inch orifice, the air compressor is able to maintain the required CFM at 60 psi. And while I do have doubts about the charts that show CFM requirements for various orifice size, I also suspect that California Air Tools may be a little optimistic in their specs. Regardless, for my needs, I'm very satisfied with this combination of air compressor and sandblaster. This is what I use for a vacuum and dust collection around the shop. It's a Fein vacuum, spelled F-E-I-N, from the German manufacturer Fein Power Tools. It's coupled to a small cyclonic dust separator called a dust deputy from United Air Systems. The combination of the dust deputy and the HEPA filter of the Fein vacuum works well. The vacuum's power can be adjusted. When used with the blasting cabinet, it's probably best to use the lowest power setting. Too much suction will just waste abrasive. These are clean glass beads magnified 45 times. These are glass beads extracted from the vacuum. They have broke down slightly and there is some debris, but mainly this shows that the power setting of the vacuum is too high. Even in the winter, with a small compressor, it's still important to use a water separator. This is after probably 15 minutes of use. If the water is not separated from the airstream, it will cause the glass beads to clump. This will clog the siphon tube and prevent uptake of the abrasive. It's surprising how much static builds up around the sandblasting cabinet, and you may consider grounding the grating inside the cabinet. Nasty stickers can be removed from the glass or plastic by soaking them in vegetable oil. Let the oil work on the adhesive for a day, and then you'll be able to easily remove the label. Another improvement I'd like to make to this blasting cabinet that I didn't have time for this video is a sloping surface to help guide the abrasive material. A lot of abrasive material gets caught on the ridge that holds the grating in place. The solution could be as simple as four pieces of wood cut at a bevel. Seeing how important the right orifice size was for a sandblaster to be used on a small air compressor got me thinking about alternative orifice and nozzle designs. The abrasive is accelerated in the airstream, and the higher the velocity of the airstream, or the longer the period that the abrasive has to accelerate, the abrasive will have a higher exit velocity from the nozzle. The force of the abrasive onto the surface will be related to the square of the velocity of the abrasive. I've been simulating various orifice and nozzle designs, in particular D-Laval or convergent-divergent nozzles. Most recommendations are to avoid abrasive blasting unless you have a large air compressor. I suspect that just a small amount of optimization of the gun design could improve the efficacy of small compressors for abrasive blasting. If you have any ideas or would like to collaborate, as always, please let me know. I hope that you found this video useful. Please send any comments or suggestions you may have. And finally, I hope you'll be back for the next video.